happy. Delighted to be here. Thanks so much for the invite. The Greek word for economy is oikonos, and which means oikos means house or home. And I think what we're all here today discussing, and what we're all trying to do, is to bring the economy back home. We're trying to repatriate the economy. We want to make it more intimate and more closer to our hearts. We are all, though some of us know, some of us may not, we are all part of a movement. A movement which is maybe the end of the beginning. Yeah? It's going to grow and grow and grow. And cities like Jeonju are part of that movement, but probably more important than the city, it's the people around the world in different places who are all feeling this need of how we need to bring the economy back home. It's important that I just give you a little bit of orientation of my own organisation, because it's important in terms of how we think and how we act, what organisation we're part of. And I'm part of this organisation called the Centre for Local Economic Strategies, and we're the UK's leading organisation dedicated to looking after the local economy. Now, we work predominantly with cities and with local government. We are agents of change. We work with local government, city officials, to try and see how we can develop the economy to be more homely, yeah, to be more intimate, to have a better relationship with the place. It's also important to mention that we are not part of a university. We are not part of the state. We are part ourselves of the social economy, part ourselves of the community, part ourselves of the people. We are an independent organisation. And it's interesting speaking to, it's interesting to think about how hard that is, because of the nature of the economy, to maintain that independence. That we're not part of the state, we're not part of a commercial world, we're working in a way that's kind of different. For instance, 30 years ago, our founding mothers and fathers of my organisation said, let's not put that organisation in London. Because every organisation is a big thinker, an organisation goes to London of our time. They put us in Manchester, our regional city. Yeah. We also have very little hierarchy in our organisation. I am the chief executive, but in a sense we all kind of do the same thing in our organisation, and the pay scales are quite equal. We also sponsor community activity as well. So we actually practice what we preach, if you like. I am an economist to trade, so don't boo. I was once at a conference and I said, has anybody heard of my organisation? And some bright spark said, yes, you're an economist that's weird. Went strange. And I suppose we have went a bit strange, because we believe in economic and social growth. If you think about a spectrum, on the one hand, there's traditional ways we look at the economy, which is about economic growth, and the other side of the spectrum would be people who think very different. We, in a sense, are unfaithful or polygamous. We are married to the traditional and work with them and local government officials every day. But we're actually in love with the punk, the hippie, the different, and we try to work between the two to bring the alternative and the different into everyday practice. Our bread and butter work is focused on local economic strategies, building ideas of how we deal with the local economy, how we install markets. We have done work on well-being, working with the UK government on their well-being programme. We've just finished some work with the Scottish government. You may have heard my accent, I am Scottish. The Scottish government will be measured every 479 towns of Scotland, a couple of 1,000 people, and measured how strong their local economy was. And we're a delivery partner with many organisations around the UK and beyond. So we're at this interface, we're at this place between great places, good lives, and the economy. We are socially and environmentally ambitious for the economy. We obviously are fueled with ecological, environmental principles. But for us, our focus is more on social justice and inequality, wealth inequality. That's more of our focus, though, of course, we are cognizant and we understand the importance of the environment. Kenneth Boulding, the famous economist, said, "The only people who believe in infinite growth in a finite world are madmen and economists." We have a challenge in the world today, a big challenge. We are in the age of the unreason, in the age of the unreasonable. This here is a term I've made up called boom goggles. It's the term where you put a pair of spectacles on, and all you see is infinite growth. Build a new bridge, growth. Build a new dam, growth. You put these goggles, and it's a condition. Helena talked about a blindness. It's a false pair of spectacles that we think that the next boom is just around the corner. We have a story from Scotland, where I come from, the Highlands of Scotland. A rich man visits a small fishing village. There he meets a fisherman. He admires the fish caught by the man. He says, "Oh, you're a good fisherman." The man says, "Yes, I caught this fish this morning. I'll use some myself. What I don't use, I'll give to the rest of my family. I may sell some. And then in the afternoon, I can play with my children. I can work in my garden. And at night, I play the fiddle. I take time to look at stars." And the rich man says, "Oh, why don't you come into partnership with me? We can get a bigger boat. We can catch more fish. And in 10 years, we can really employ people." "Then what?" says the fisherman. "Oh, of course you could retire. You're a rich man. You're a success. You can play with your children. You can walk in your garden. You can play with the fiddle." And the fisherman says, "I do that now." What we have here, in no way should we think of localization as in some say going back to the past. We use our iPads, our phones. We need this, we want this to go away. What we have here is a need to make a transition between a level of economic gain and then a tipping point occurs where we need to not max on economic growth, we max on lifestyle. We max on well-being, we max on happiness. The trick is for us as a society and as a place to think, we have made economic gain, we are wealthy, let's now max on something else. Let's have an economy ticking on in a steady way if we think about doing other things. It's the exponential nature of economic growth that's the problem. And that is the challenge, to think about that fisherman who says, "Yes, I have economic gain, that's enough. I now max on something else." I'm a fan of Adam Smith. Who's heard of Adam Smith? Hands up. Oh, you're intelligent. Oh, sounds brilliant. He inspires me, and this is a particularly good book he has. It's a foreword by Amartya Sen, the Indian philosopher. And we all stand on the shoulders of giants, don't we? I think sometimes we think our own world is so important, we actually, all of us, stand on the shoulders of giants. And he is a giant. 18th century Edinburgh, where my wife comes from. He wrote two books. One, The Wealth of Nations, which is a story of how the economy works, I suppose, the science of economics. And the second one, The Theory of Moral Sentiments, which is a much more interesting book. And in fact, it's actually Smith's lifetime work. He rewrote it maybe, I think, six, seven or eight times. But he's more famous for The Wealth of Nations. And what's important about this book is he talks about empathy, enlightened self-interest. He says that conscience arises from economic relationships. A man's or woman's inclination is tit for empathy. And the act of trading, the act of exchange, the act of giving, sharing, or the act of giving and then somebody giving me money for it, yeah, is actually a deep emotional thing. There's a relationship there that's very important. And it's warm, there's a warmth to it. And what's happened, I think, in global capitalism terms, is we've lost that warmth. We've lost that empathy. We've lost that intimacy. We've lost that relationship with the producer. And that's what we need to find again. And Smith said, I quote, "No society can be flourishing or happy of which the greater part of the members are poor and miserable." He says that we cannot have a good society unless we look after the poor and the misfortunate in a better way. I think there's good times. There's good times. Everywhere I go and speak to people like you, as I have been in the last few days, I hear optimism. Helena talked this morning about a paradigm shift. We are in that moment now, and we're all part of that. How exciting. We're almost cursed, but also lucky. We're cursed because we're living in such difficult times, but we're lucky because we can build a new society, a better one than before. I also have many constructive... I'm a society and a culture where debate and argument is the way one goes about things. I like to argue. I'm a culture that does that. And typically I have arguments all the time with the left, the left wing, who says the way to solve the problems is more collective state action. And then I also have arguments with the right, who say the state needs to get out of the way. I don't think the future is left or right. I think the future is probably a bit of both. In my work, in terms of this bringing the local economy home, we've been searching to think, what way can we conceptualise, think through places, the economy of places, and what are the component parts that make them virtuous and decent and good? What we're interested in is, how does an economy respond well to shock? We all know the places, don't we, where they seem to just operate better than other places. They're a better economy, they're more virtuous, they're more social. But some places are not so much. Also, some places when there's an environmental change or there's some shock, manage to respond positively. But some places don't. What is the character? So we call it the body factor. How do places respond positively to adversity? What are the qualities? And the qualities we have, quite in simple terms, there is not just one economy, there's three. There's three. There's the commercial economy, which is wealth creation. There's the public economy, which I mean by the state, something that comes out of taxes. And then there's the social economy. Great places, great local economies of all those three working well, interdependent of each other, cooking on gas. Places that are not good don't have these independent things, three elements. I'll give you an example of the social economy, how important is it? My next door neighbour, who's recently passed away, was called John. He was an old man of about 80. He was from Poland. And John used to say to me and my wife, could you go to the shop and get me some bread and sausages? Because he was infirm, so he had bad legs. He would give me £20. I would go to the shop and buy him bread and sausages. I would come back, give him the bread and sausages and the change. We all do these things every day. I am no saint. It's just something we do. Just imagine if I didn't do that, or everybody didn't do that sort of thing. It's been worked out. In the UK, the value of looking after elderly relatives or looking after elderly neighbours is worth £86 billion. If you put a value on it, it can't, it's not being, there's no money passes hands. Imagine how bad our economy would be, how society would be. What would happen to the state if we had to find £86 billion to look after the elderly relatives or to look after elderly neighbours? The social economy is the core economy. If we disrespect that, every other element, including the public economy and commercial economy, won't work well and will fall. There's Professor Edgar Cann, the inventor of time banks. He talks about this social economy as the core economy. And he used the example of a computer. He says that this social economy is the operating system, like Microsoft Office Vista. It's the operating system. Schools, hospitals, businesses are only the programs. They are Excel, PowerPoint, Microsoft Word. The social economy is the operating system. If it goes wonky, your programs won't work. Your schools will collapse, your business will collapse. So there's importance that we factor in the social economy back into the local economy and see it as three interdependent elements to it. I have three quick examples of work that we've been involved in to illustrate some of these things I've been talking about. The first one is from a small market, a small example. This is Ashton-under-Lyne in Manchester. The council was very worried about its decline. How did they plan to make it more economically successful? What we did was we analysed it in terms of its commercial function, but also its social and its public function, its wider role in place. So we didn't measure it in terms of how well it was functioning in the commercial economy, but in other terms as well. We mapped this. Now this is it, can't see this very well, but what we did was we would go into a cafe and we would do an assessment of the extent to which that cafe was commercially successful, through quantitative data, but more importantly, what social function it played in that community. How social was that cafe? And we found this interesting, we tried to find that, Starbucks was less social than the local independent cafe. Less people interacted socially in Starbucks than they did in the independent cafe. So what we did here was to try and change the way we think about planning. We're thinking here about plants of land use plan, if you like. We're thinking here, don't just plan in terms of commercial. You say commercial, but a percentage more social than other commercial spaces. We're trying to break up the idea of the economy being just about commercial success in a planning sense. Yeah. This was very helpful to the council, made them think about how the use of space and the use of the market. Ideally, the challenge, and the big challenge, is to try and think, how do we adopt planning principles that start to think through these ideas too? Another thing to think about is, as we mentioned, is around the plugging the leaks. We need to think about how things leak out of the economy. External contractors, food suppliers, no local shop, invest outside the area. We need to think about how we plug those leaks, and some of the examples given previously are exactly the right thing to do. It means looking at public sector contracts and how do we make sure that public sector buy lots of things, like paper, toilet rolls, pencils. How do we make sure that's more local suppliers rather than distant suppliers? It's about looking at living wage. It's about looking at local energy production. There's a range of things to stop that money leaking out of the economy. Again, there's a diagram just to explain that a bit more. Opposed to money not landing in a locality, it's about how do we funnel money through so it lands in the streets and in a particular place. Another example here is from Newcastle, a neighbourhood called Walker. This is a crowdfunding initiative in which local people and businesses pay to break bread together, to have a dinner, with the surplus profits going into funding community action. It's such a simple idea, it's so beautiful, I think, in terms of simplicity. It's been set up in Walker. The first one is happening next month, which I'm going to. They've raised £20,000. The dinner will cost around £1,000. That means there's £19,000 that's going to go to community groups to fund the social economy so that they can do more. Another thing to think about is how do we stretch the value of our money to make it go further. We've done some work with small businesses in the UK, and for every pound spent with a small business, 63 pence is re-spent locally. For every pound spent for a large business, only 40 pence is re-spent locally. So with small businesses, you get bigger bang for your bucks in terms of the attention within the local economy. Finally, an example from Preston in Northern England, which was a major piece of work which we've been doing now for 2 years. Preston is quite a poor area. It suffers from post-industrialisation. It has much youth unemployment. And it has tried lots of the big infrastructure developments. It's tried to get global investment in to the location, but it's still got enduring social problems. And they've set up this community wealth initiative through six anchor institutions. The anchors are two local authorities, two local governments, one housing provider, the university, the police, and the fire. They've all joined together and they've said, how can we adopt spending practices, human resource practices, which means that people in Preston benefit, businesses benefit, and local people benefit. What can we do differently? They are anchoring themselves in those places and they're saying, come on, we are citizens too. What can we do as institutions to help this place? Collectively, they have £750 million. We surveyed that money. Only 5% of that money was spent in Preston. Only 5%. The less was bought by all over England and beyond. And we reckoned 1% of that money, though 1% more, could probably bring about 1,000 new jobs. We've already had successes on this. We've already seen £5 million being re-spent locally through the direct action. We've seen a change in some of the employment practices of those organisations. This is about grounding an economy in a place, and it's about those big anchor organisations like universities saying, putting their hand up and saying, we want to do more for this place. We want to bring this economy back home. Finally, just to say, I have 7 points to finish on. One, places have wealth already. We need to grab it and harness it better. Two, we need to think about how the commercial, social and public sectors work better together, interdependence between them. Three, economic development is not just about the economy, it's about social growth. Four, we need the local government and local state to enable change to happen. Five, the business sector is not just about growth, it can also play a philanthropic role with society. Six, the social sector is core. It is the basis to a decent local economy. And seventh, we need to experiment. There's no easy answer to the answers. Just trying, fumbling around, trying stuff. But there's a hankering, a desire to try some more stuff. We need to experiment and try things. I would say, I don't know what the future will be. I don't know if it's socialism, I don't know if it's capitalism. But it will be something in between that will be the future, and I'm happy and optimistic about that future. Thank you very much for listening.